From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
My name is Romain Pirracchio. I'm an associate and statistical editor with JAMA, professor of anesthesia, critical care, and biostatistics at UCSF. And I'm here today to discuss two articles that were published in JAMA on January the 21st. The first one by Bennett and co-authors, titled Development and Validation of the Phoenix Criteria for Pediatric Sepsis and Septic Shock, and the second one by Watson and collaborators, titled International Consensus Criteria for Pediatric Sepsis and Septic Shock. And I had the pleasure to be here today to discuss these results with Dr. Hallie Prescott, Associate Professor in Pulmonary and Critical Care Medicine at University of Michigan and Staff Physician at Ann Arbor VA Hospital. Along with our colleagues, Dr. Carlton and Perry Heady, Dr. Prescott wrote an editorial in JAMA titled Context and Implication of the New Pediatric Sepsis Criteria. And I'm here also with Dr. Roberto Jabornisky, professor and chair of the pediatric department at Northeastern National Medical School in Argentina. And along with his colleagues, Dr. Cooperman and Dr. Gonzalez-Tambroskas, Dr. Jabornisky wrote a second editorial titled Transitioning from SIRS, which stands from Systemic Inflammatory Response Syndrome, to Phoenix with the updated pediatric sepsis criteria. So without further ado, I'm going to jump directly into the topic and ask both of you essentially the same question about your perspective on these two papers and the reason why you believe these studies were actually timely and important. So I'm going to start off with you, Hallie.
Yeah, great. Thanks. It's really a pleasure to be here this morning. Yeah, I thought this was really just an excellent body of work that was done. I think that, as we discuss in the editorial, this term sepsis has been around for millennia, but we're still sort of grappling with what exactly does that mean and how do we best measure it? And so the 2016 sepsis 3 in adults had moved from a SIRS criteria-based definition and this conceptualization of sepsis as an overwhelming inflammatory response to now thinking about this as a dysregulated host response and identifying it based on individuals with acute organ dysfunction secondary to infection. And that work back in 2016 was really all done in adults, but I think it sort of really got the ball rolling in pediatricians thinking that, well, you know, this really applies to children as well. And so this task force was convened back in 2019 and has done a bunch of work really to move this forward to, this included a survey, a systematic review of what we know about factors associated with sepsis and associated with mortality among children with sepsis, and then a cohort study to all inform these new pediatric sepsis criteria. So I think that this builds off sort of the line of thinking that was set in motion a while back, but brings a ton of sort of rigorous research and data to inform the ultimate product.
Thank you, Hallie. Roberto, so why do you think these studies were actually important for the pediatrician community?
First of all, I want to thank JAMA because this is very important. As Hallie just said, we don't know really what sepsis is. And now we have this definition. So this huge effort that maybe 5 or 6 years they spend to really talk which are the criteria, not only the definition. We have the definition. We said for the medical scientific society, this is sepsis. But how we recognize sepsis? Which are the criteria, especially in pediatrics? Because before that, we have one definition in 2005, but it was more a PQ-based or an expert-based definition for the people working in a pediatric intensive care, not for the people outside the hospital in low-resource settings where the majority of children, the majority of infants and adolescents have sepsis. There is a long way to go because, as Holly said, really don't know what is sepsis. And maybe we will never know what is sepsis because there are many sepsis.
Thank you so much, Roberto. So what I'm hearing is very interesting. We actually needed a definition for sepsis, and there was sort of this general understanding growing out in the critical care community that we could sort of rely on a definition that reflects the extent of the inflammatory response to an infection and the fact that organs are actually involved. And so the interesting thing here is that we have two different articles. The first one tried to develop pediatric-specific organ dysfunction system to then sort of like use this new system to define sepsis based on organ dysfunction as measured by this new score. So I'd like to dive a little deeper into these two articles and maybe turn it over to you, Hallie, to sort of give us your perspective about the first paper by Bennett and co-authors that defines sort of sepsis based on that.
Yeah, great. So in this study, the authors pulled together a cohort of electronic health record data. These were children in multiple different countries who presented to the emergency department or to the hospital and were being treated for infection. And the sort of big question that they were trying to ask are, what are the specific criteria that we can use to best discriminate mortality, children to survive versus children who will die of their illness? And so the first step they took was to look at 8 different individual organ dysfunctions and ask, for that individual organ dysfunction, what are the best criteria? And they looked at potential criteria from 5 different existing sort of summary organ dysfunction scoring systems, as well as some additional organ-specific criteria. And so they found, you know, the best approach for cardiovascular, the best approach for respiratory, the best approach for neurological, and so on. And then in step 2, they asked which of these organ dysfunction criteria are necessary to sort of optimize this model. And it was actually, you know, I was somewhat surprised, but a 4 system model. So cardiovascular, coagulation, neurologic, and respiratory, just those 4 systems performed as well statistically as using all 8 organ systems. And then after developing this criteria, they validated these in a holdout sample of patients, right? So patients that hadn't been used to develop the model, they then tested it in this sort of holdout sample. And that's the sort of optimal recommended approach to make sure that you don't have overly optimistic assessment of your model fit statistics because they were developed on the same patients you're testing them on. So overall, a very systematic and I think rigorous approach to going about and doing this.
Thank you so much, Hallie. So is it fair to say that this first paper sort of aimed at developing what is available and what, you know, we've relied on for adults, meaning the SOFA score? So the goal was to sort of like develop a score such as the SOFA score in adults to sort of like now base the definition on that.
Yeah, right. So I think in the prior work in adults, they had looked at a few different overall organ dysfunction scores. The difference here was that they took this step of first identifying for each individual organ system what was the best score. And so I thought that was a nice approach to going about and doing this.
Thank you so much. Okay, so now we have a score that, you know, for all the reasons detailed by Hallie, like performs well and is nicely validated. So Roberto, can you tell us how this score was actually used to now provide a new definition for sepsis and septic shock in pediatric patients?
With this criteria, at 2024, maybe in 5 years, we will change it. But at this time, this social construction between the community, the scientific community, is to say this is sepsis. So when you research, when you are doing your research and you call sepsis or you call septic shock, they must have this criteria. But this criteria must be also be researched on a low and middle income setting, because there is a problem. For high income countries, mainly from US hospital, the mortality for sepsis or the mortality for septic shock was 3 or 4 times less than the mortality for sepsis or for septic shock in low and middle resources.
Thank you so much, Roberto. I want to follow up on that and ask you a little bit about how generalizable this criteria are. And especially patients with sepsis are encountered in different environments, of course, in critical care, but also outside in the emergency department, in clinics, and as you mentioned, in high and in intermediate and low income countries. How do you think operationally this new criteria can be used across the board?
There is an interesting, and for me, it's a very good diagnostic flow that the author has put in the paper. That is, when you have an unwell child in front of you and it's with fever, you can check if this child, infant, adolescent, maybe could have sepsis. Just check it. And if you are in a very low resource setting and you don't have anything, but you see that this child is unwell, please send him or send her to a hospital. And after that, if you are in an emergency department, check if they have organ failure. If you think they have organ failure, begin to treat that organ failure. And after that, check how they are done with the Phoenix score. If the Phoenix score is positive for sepsis, that is sepsis. Don't wait to make the pediatric sepsis score to treat organ failures in an infant, in a child, or in an adolescent.
Thank you so much, Roberto. Ali, what do you think the clinical impact will be?
Yeah, thanks. I think that these criteria are very helpful for tracking, reporting, to see if we're making improvements over time or to look for differences across hospitals and settings, because it has this kind of like very precise definition of, you know, what organ dysfunction are going to qualify a patient for sepsis. Whereas before, I think there was a lot of variability in terms of who ultimately got labeled as sepsis, because there was a little bit of a disconnect, I think, between the actual SIRS criteria and then sort of what we were sort of mentally conceptualizing as a patient with sepsis. Whereas this, I feel like, is better in alignment. I think this is also helpful for, you know, kind of being alarm bells to saying, yeah, these are criteria that say your patient is at a much higher risk of a poor outcome. I think that, you know, the sort of clinical challenge that we sort of all still face that is not directly addressed by these criteria is that diagnosing infection is still a challenge, right? And when SIRS criteria came out of the definition, I felt like there was some confusion in the field, in the adult field, that, oh, these are no longer helpful, they're not useful, like that's why they're no longer here. And that's not really the reason. The reason is because we don't think they really define this threshold where your response to infection is now leading to collateral damage. But they're actually quite helpful for trying to help sort of risk stratify or factors that you can sort of use as you're trying to understand, is this a patient with infection or not? And I think that's a challenge that we face every day. And so in clinical practice, I think we need to say, you know, is this a patient that we believe is infected? You know, do they meet criteria for sepsis? But on the flip side, I think we also need to be always asking this question, oh, we have a, you know, a child or a patient with new organ dysfunction. Could this be due to infection, right? Because sometimes it's not obvious and we don't want to miss that. So I think it's, you know, important to sort of come at it from both directions, from infection as well as from acute organ dysfunction.
Well, Ali, Roberto, thank you very much. It was a pleasure talking to you. I am Romain Pirracchio. I've been speaking with Dr. Prescott and Dr. Jabornisky about the Phoenix score and the new criteria for sepsis and septic shock in pediatric patients with sepsis. You can find a link to this article in the episode description. And to follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us at jamanetworkaudio.com. Or search for JAMA Network wherever you can get podcasts. The episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks a lot for listening.